I'm glad to welcome you here tonight to an evening highlighting voices of transformation. Now, to begin with just a few practical matters, there are several exits from this room, two on either side here at the front and three at the back, and there are washrooms also located off the lobby area at the back. Following this evening's presentation, there will be a time of conversation and refreshments. I see the refreshments are already there, time to enjoy them afterward as well. We are so pleased to be able to offer a special art display tonight entitled Picture This, Exploring the Lived Experience of Stroke Survivors, using the methodology of photo voice as a collaborative approach between five stroke recovery participants and researchers from the University of British Columbia. The participants, or co-researchers, if you will, all members of the stroke recovery program that meets here at Shaughnessy Heights every Tuesday. They are the experts of their experience, and the research team facilitated the inquiry process. So this study, under the supervision of Professor Tal Yaris, offers new insights into supports, services, and barriers that exist within the community and how that impacts stroke survivors' participation. We're grateful that all involved with the project have agreed to share the display with us tonight, and many of the students are available. Many of those involved with the project are available tonight to talk about it. Like so many other institutions in our society, the church finds itself in the midst of great change. But at least for the church, this is not new. Change has happened over the ages in many, many ways. Now, the people of this congregation are aware of many of the changes around and within, have been seeking to understand a way through it all. This evening is part of our hope to invite a broader conversation beyond the congregation in the wider community. We're glad that you're here to join as we all seek meaning for our lives in the world today. And now to introduce our guest speaker tonight and to guide our time of conversation after, I welcome Ian Hanneman Singh from CBC's News Now. Ian is no stranger to Canadians who have trusted him as a thoughtful and clarifying journalist for many, many years. Award-winning and affable, gracious and charming, a good friend of Shaughnessy Heights United Church, and a graduate of caregiving in the subterranean nursery here, please welcome our host for this evening, Ian Hanneman.
Very much for devoting some of your Sunday evening to coming here. The thing to keep in mind over the next hour and a half or so is that this is intended not only to be illuminating but also interactive. And so James is going to be coming around with a microphone after the main part of the presentation. James, are you in here right now? You
can,
just kind of see. So think about your questions. And the questions, here's my experience when groups of people have questions for esteemed guests like tonight, is that people are really intimidated about asking the first and the second and third question. I think it has to be profound and perfect. Don't feel like you have to hit that standard. We want to have a good conversation here. This is all about the message that you're hearing and the questions you have. So keep in mind that there'll be an opportunity to ask questions. And the other thing I find is that when we get to the end of the question and answer session, all of a sudden a lot of people are crowding around the microphone wishing that they had jumped in earlier, right? So do jump in early on, have your questions, don't be afraid. If you're sitting towards the back and you want to come closer to the front, there's still lots of room, and I think this is going to be a fascinating discussion, and keep in mind that's exactly what it's going to be, is a discussion. So Grant Gillett, who's here, who's come in from New Zealand, and we're all amazed, those of us who don't do that flight the way you do it, that you actually left today, whatever today means, and still wide awake. and ready to go, and so that by itself is impressive, but there's more about Grant that's impressive than his ability to fly and speak. He's a professor of biomedical ethics at the University of Otago, New Zealand. He's qualified in medicine, psychology, neurosurgery, and philosophy. I'm laughing because it just seems so improbable, but it's true. Has lectured in physiological psychology, bioethics, philosophy, and cognitive neuroscience. Now keep in mind, by contrast, my big credential when I was introduced is that I'm affable. Grant's resume goes on, and it sounds as impressive and complex as the line I read, so I encourage you to read more about him, but you're going to learn key things about what he's here to speak about right now as he begins his presentation. Grant?
Well, thank you very much for having me here. I'm going to do this as a kind of intellectual journey which I want to share with you. So I want you to picture a somewhat stroppy and non-conformist student at high school who was interested in deep issues.
Okay, let me just jump in and say, the one thing we were told today is make sure your audio works perfectly, and it's buzzing a little bit, so just your indulgence. Let's see, as if I know how to fix this, but anyway, hopefully it sounds like maybe something's a little bit loose, so let's see, just give me one second here, talk to yourselves once again. Okay, just try talking again.
Okay.
Yeah, there was a bit of a buzz, but I think it's gone away now.
Is it? Can you still hear me?
Okay.
Do I need to...
Maybe it's a bit more around here.
Do I need to go over here?
Okay, that's good.
Is that good?
Okay,
excellent. Can you hear, Greg?
So I shouldn't get in front of wherever your speakers are. Yeah, okay.
All right. See, I told you it was informal here, so I'm just going
to
keep going.
Okay, so here's this person. No idea how to ask these questions, but determined to ask them anyway, so I... You'll be like that tonight. And growing up in a tiny corner of the world, really. The Google map is of Auckland. You'll notice it's a kind of an isthmus. It's a kind of narrow piece of land between a landmass to the north and a landmass to the south. And the two coastlines almost meet. In fact, there is a creek, a little stream, partly tidal, which our indigenous people used to push canoes along to get from one coastline to the other. And I lived in this little place called Blockhouse Bay. The blockhouse was a colonial development of a Maori lookout. The lookout commanded a major entrance to the Manukau Harbour, where tribes raiding up the west coast could get access to tribes who'd settled in the isthmus, which was a very fertile area. If I were introducing myself in a Maori context, I would say which mountain I grew up near, which overshadowed my life, and that for me would be the Waitakere's. Which river was most associated with the fertility and productivity of the place that I grew up in, and that would be the Waikato River. Which marae I came from, or village-sized grouping of people. And that would be Blockhouse Bay itself, like a little suburb. And which kind of tribal or racial group I associate with. And we have this term in New Zealand made up from a Maori term, Ngāti, which indicates a big tribal grouping. And Pākehā, which is the Maori name for people of European descent, foreigners, strangers. pale-faced people from other places. So I'm Ngāti Pākehā. It's not just an affectation, because growing up as a Caucasian in New Zealand inflects your life in a way that no other setting quite does. For me, my life was also inflected by a lot of reading. And I read a lot about Oxford, England, Scotland. Those were the things that really gripped me in my soul, as it were. Oxford in particular. I'll tell you about my gargoyle a little bit later. I went to Oxford to do a degree in philosophy. I didn't actually go there to do a degree. I went there to be a neurosurgeon working for the British National Hospital Service, the NHS. But I was seduced sideways by the possibility of doing a DPhil in Oxford in philosophy. And because of all the questions I'd asked, that just seemed like a natural fit. So I couldn't resist. So, Oxford, punting on the river. My kids, we had four kids by the time we went there, loved punting. They especially loved it because at least 40% of the time, Dad, who did the punting, also managed to fall in the river, which was hilarious. My office was in the cloisters at Moreland College, pictured there, looking from the courtyard and looking from out of the cloisters to what we called Founders Tower. Moreland is one of the colleges of Oxford. There was about 23, there's now about 28. The University of Oxford is an abstract entity. It now has an administrative structure, but it's a kind of emergent reality out of the colleges. And that's important for what I'm going to say about the soul.
Just excuse me for a moment. We're just going to play with your mic for one more second. And can you come in and make sure it's your mic? Okay.
Just thinking that this is not.
We're just playing with the microphone for just one moment.
Okay. Oh, my voice is going to get a lot less strained, and your ears are going to get a lot less strained as well, so that's good. So, the University of Oxford emerges out of this higher order entity that the colleges give rise to. Mine was Moreland College, founded in the 15th century. And a lovely old college. It was quite understandable that when we thought of moving back to New Zealand and Dunedin and the medical school at Otago offered me a job as a philosopher and neurosurgeon, that wasn't a common offer for a university to make. But when we went back there, we felt to some extent at home. You can see that the architecture has got certain resonances. That's our main university building. You can see the kind of houses that exist in Dunedin. You can get a sense that, again, it's a place nestled at the foot of a sea lock with an oceanic coast right next door. Ever since I was young, I'd been attracted to the mysteries of the brain. That just seemed so fascinating. When I got to med school, it was the first topic that really, really gripped me. I'd had my philosophical fascinations. I briefly flirted with Hinduism, briefly flirted with Buddhism. They were virtually the same. And about halfway through my medical education, I decided to devote a year to research on the brain for a master's degree in psychology. I learned that the brain was a network of associations, picking up information from the world around us and combining it in various ways, depending on how experience unfolded. The result of those combinations was to produce a person with a unique history. All of the experiences of that person built into who they were, how they reacted, how they felt about things, and the substrate of their thinking. And every experience they had as they lived in the world changed the whole, just a little. It grew and developed. So the process you're going through here is actually indicative of a process that every human being is going through all their lives. Producing new nerve cells right into the 9th, 10th decade of life, building them in to networks that reflect their ongoing experience and come up with a new reality, a new way of being human, with a lot of carryovers from the way you've been before, but new possibilities all the time. The person who first really clearly saw this was the father of British neurology, a man called John Hewlings Jackson. He happened to found the hospital, one of the hospitals that I worked in London, the National Hospital for Nervous and Mental Diseases at Queen's Square in North London, on the edge of Bloomsbury. And he noticed that the higher mental life that we associate with human beings is actually an elaboration from an evolution, a historical and a developmental, individual developmental point of view of just ways of reacting to the world. You start off with very simple ways and you build more complexity in. You start off with your knee able to jerk whenever anybody bangs the tendon with a hammer. You then realize that jerking your knee whenever something arrives is just not the best thing to do. So you jerk sometimes and not others. You then realize that jerking in a particular way is very useful if you're playing a game of football. So in those situations, you learn to lay in just another layer of elaboration. Eventually, you end up with this highly elaborate way of responding to the world, with all kinds of nuances in it. And in the meantime, the very simple inputs and outputs no longer have an automatic connection between them. They go via these indirect, tortuous routes which pull in the experiences you had yesterday. Whether somebody was nice to you, the thing you learned about, that maybe women don't completely appreciate it when every remark about human beings in general is put in the masculine gender. That begins to inflect the way you talk. The reactions become that much more complicated, so that no longer can we say, oh look, this is a person is like a puppet caused to jerk this way and that, depending on how the strings are pulled. That doesn't seem right. What seems right is that it depends a whole lot on what that person has become to begin to say what that person will do in any given situation. Because at certain points, the information coming in is resisted, and at other points, it's facilitated. As to whether you feel caught up in the idea or repelled by it. The result is that your whole body, the way it feels about things, the way it reacts to things, becomes the way that you as a person are in the world. And so we end up with this idea that as highly evolved creatures, something has happened which has taken us beyond the kind of simple systems that we're used to studying. And getting the layers right that go into this new kind of study becomes a really difficult thing to do. In fact, we can see it illustrated in some experiments that have been done over the last few years. These experiments show a person who's in a vegetative state. We got the buzz. That's, and a person who's healthy. And what those little loops are showing you is how far away from each other and how intensely active the various connections in the brain that are actually working are. So it's those pictures at the bottom are extracted mathematically and put in that form to make them easy to see. But it shows that a healthy, conscious person has got widely spread areas of their brain actively dealing with information, each in its own way, and all that is being combined into an overall response to whatever situation they find themselves in. Whereas a person who's actually mainly unconscious or deeply unconscious and has got no capacity really to recover, has got very short connections, acting at a very low level. The blue colours indicate low activity, the red and yellow colours indicate high activity, and the greens are somewhere in between. These experiments were done in Paris and confirmed a remark that was made in the end of the 19th century, actually by a French psychiatrist called Ribot. Moi, c'est une coordination. I am a coordination or integration of a whole lot of things, each of which may seem simple. I reach out for a cup. I notice my wife walking in the room. I feel warmed and gratified by seeing a smile on the face of my children. But combined in me in an absolutely unique way that they would not be combined in anybody else. And this results in what we call consciousness. Being aware of the world in your own particular way, with all the shades of meaning, understanding, relationship that you bring to your experience of the world. All recorded there, laid down potentially in your brain and actively mobilized in response to the situations you find yourself in. I won't go through all the detail here, it's all far too complicated. I don't understand the mathematics, one of my students does. I write papers with him, he does the maths, I just run the commentary. But actually the line of thinking is very old. It's even older than the 19th century. This bottom figure Well, the top figure is John Locke, the royal physician at the end of the 17th century, 1689, who wrote a major book called the Treatise of an essay concerning human understanding. And at that time, science was just beginning to find out about the world. And Locke said, we won't really know what things really are until we've found out how that bit of nature works. How that bit of nature does what it does its thing in its own particular way. So, if we're thinking about humans, conscious human beings and what they do, there's a challenge. How do human beings, doing what they do in their own individual ways, work? They've got brains, but how do those brains work? And what I've just mentioned before is a bit of a clue to that. But we can go even further back than the 17th century, right back to about 250 BC, over 2,000 years ago, when Aristotle was thinking about the same problem. And Aristotle, made a couple of remarks here that are extremely telling. He thought about the soul and the body. The soul, the person you are, the person with your own mind and intellect and way of reacting to the world in your own distinctive way. And he thought about the eye. And he remarked, the soul is to the body as sight is to the eye. A very profound remark when you think about it. The moment we try to understand sight, it's not enough to dissect an eye. Not even enough to look under the microscope at a living eye. You need to understand what an eye does for the creature whose eye it is. What does an eye do for an animal? An eye connects that animal to the world and all sorts of things around it in ways that seem almost magical. If somebody moves out in the corridor and alters the pattern of light there, I will know that somebody has moved out there. I don't have to be right there touching them. My eye will tell me. My eye unlocks the secrets of the world for me. And it does it by a particular mechanism that has a role in the way I work in the world. But if I wasn't a person who walked around and touched things, learned what they're really like and how hard they are and what the colours correlate with and all that kind of thing, the eye wouldn't be any use to me at all. It's only because I'm a real creature that does all those things that the eye gives me anything worth knowing at all. So now think of the soul. I'm a real creature who does things. I get attracted to people. I feel certain desires and urges. I develop certain bonds and connections and ways of reacting, habits. Put all those things together and you've got a very an unfolding story about how I live in the world. So on the one hand, we've got the eye, a physical bit of me, and a whole story about what vision gives me. On the other hand, I've got my body, a physical object in the world, and a whole story about how I am in the world, my soul. What about this other one? The soul is its objects.
who's really thinking about the kinds of things that have made you the kind of person you are. I took one of you and dumped you on Mount Kilimanjaro. We've just heard over dinner that some of you will do quite well, but others of you might be completely helpless. You're just not used to interacting with mountains 19,500 feet high. Or if we took some of you and put you in the middle of a tropical jungle, you might starve to death, despite the abundance of food around you, because your soul is not in tune with those objects. Putting you as a particular person you are in that setting doesn't connect you up in the right way. On the other hand, if we were to take a person who was raised in that jungle, and we were to dump them over in North Vancouver and ask them to find their way to the University of British Columbia, they might be just as helpless. They would see people getting on things which moved quite fast. They would see little bits of paper handed over. They would see people looking at funny signs on posts which seemed to have marks on them. But none of those things would connect them up with how the city actually works. They haven't got the right kind of soul. Of course, in one way they have, potentially they've got the right kind of soul, because potentially they can learn all those things. They can make room in their soul for all these new ways of knowing. But they're not there just to start with. So that's what Aristotle is saying. Our world is full of meaning, full of things which are significant. If you know how to interact with them, they do things for you and you can do things to them, and those things turn out to be highly useful things to do, good things to do, joyful things to do, enriching things to do, all that. But unless you're fitted in the right kind of way, it just doesn't work. So that's why it says the soul is its object. A remark was picked up by a German philosopher called Heidegger. And that's why I remark in the bottom of the slide, one's soul is formed within one's narrative and context. What's your story? What's your context? Now I actually know a lot about all these details to be filled in, which I can only find out by finding out more about you, by having conversations with you, by figuring out which things really matter to you, which things move you and connect you and cause you to make commitments. I can only find those things out, not just by categorizing you as a person in a particular culture and context, but getting to know the actual individual, unique person whom you are. Let's think here of just one thought. That slide shows the right side of the brain being all natural and the left side of the brain being all bureaucratic. It's a simplification, of course, but actually there's a lot of truth in it. Actually, we do live in two registers. One register where we actually do stuff, where we actually jump in the water and feel it on our skin, and eat good food, and sometimes let ourselves down by going to McDonald's, and all that kind of stuff. And another register where we talk about stuff, where we make pictures, where we put symbols and signals and written out bits of idea in the place of the things and think about them as the things themselves, which they're not. And sometimes the ideas we get from the second register, the register of talking about stuff, overwhelm the ideas we get from the first Buddhist. The idea about the rest of where we actually interact with things. For that reason, you'll find a significant number of young people who are completely unable to attend to the messages their body is giving them, and completely seduced by the messages people are giving them who want to sell them certain things to do to their body, which are actually not good things to do to them. So the possibility of working between those two registers introduces a possibility of making certain systematic kinds of mistakes which some areas of our culture thrive on. They love us to make those mistakes. They love us to think that it's much more important to actually be able to buy a 63-inch television than to have some time with our family on the weekend and not quite earn so much money. They love us to think that, well, you've got slightly more colourful money here, so it's slightly more attractive, but the little pieces of paper with green and black writing on are actually much more important than sniffing good air, or feeling water on your skin, or running through a forest with children pointing out the various things that you're stumbling on. The two registers allow for distortions to creep into the soul, given the context, the objects that it's trying to connect. I'm going to just skip through some of this stuff because I want to get on to some questions. Actually, we spend a whole lot of time shaping each other's souls. No, today, if you want to make a tower, you can't just put one block on top of the other and then knock it over. I know it makes a fun noise, but that's not how to make a tower. You have to put a third one as well. And if you can, a fourth one, how many can you put? Now you've got a big tower. We are shaping a soul. We're shaping a soul to achieve something. Only by application, focus, motor coordination, visual interaction to the first signs of instability, that soul is learning something about how the world is made, how the human world is made, and how he or she can help in that cooperative process of making the world for us to live. And we're involved in that process. Because every I, me, I, how I do things, starts off as a you. You don't want to eat that, that's dirty. Have some of this. You might not like it at first, but give it a shot. Don't have any of your pudding until you've eaten your vegetables. All these things we do to each other. And we do it, have it done to us as a you who's spoken to by somebody else to start off. That's how we even get the idea that it's worth talking or thinking, because thinking is just talking inside or playing music inside or making art inside. Thinking is internalized interaction, internalized symbolic interaction, you might say. We won't talk about the mirror stage just that, because otherwise I'm just going to get all carried away. But there's another possibility that comes into being as we begin to see that we live in a world where a whole lot of people have valued us as a you before we ever became an I and learned to value ourselves. The possibility is But that's actually a much deeper and more abiding truth than you might otherwise understand from your immediate proximity. That somehow or other, the whole structure of the world is a structure to which we stand as a you and an I, and in relation to which, as a you and an I, we have to learn a certain amount of responsibility. And somehow or other, part of that whole structure of the world is a pool of, or vast sea of, intelligence just like our own. But not only intelligence, actually care. We've been cared for. If nobody cared for us, we would never have survived. So we've grown up and taken shape as the beings we are in a context in which we have been bathed in ideally and surrounded by and nurtured through care and intelligent interaction. And then it becomes possible for us to think, well, maybe there's something so profound about that, that I ought to live my whole life in the light of that, that it is the most profound truth I've ever understood about myself. Because if we do, then a certain kind of theology gets a grip on us. The theology espoused by both of these people, one of them is Emmanuel Levinas, a Lithuanian Jew who lost all his family in the Holocaust. The other is Martin Buber, lived through the same experience, wrote a significant series of books based on the theme the I and the thou. Addressing the world as if it is a world in which I cannot escape being cared for and myself addressed as an intelligent being. When I see myself that way, says Buber, and I see others as part of that reality, just in fact, a complete complement to my own reality as such a being, I see the world very differently. From a world full of objects which I can use in certain ways in the projects that I happen to have erected for myself as being of value. So, the end result of kind of following out this line of thought is that I become a being in the world with others, a whole, all hyphenated together, being in the world of others. Das Ein Mitzel, where I can use Heidegger's term. I'm distinct, and I can make myself even more distinct. I can cut myself off from others. But actually, I'm deeply related. If, in general, they had never cared for me, I would never have lived. And if, in general, they hadn't addressed me as if I were intelligent, when in fact I wasn't, I would never have become intelligent. And if in general they hadn't taught me that respect and care as an ongoing and totally unfolding thing was the most fundamental truth in the world, I would never have understood what goodness actually is. And in fact, as soon as we get there, we realize that we're saying something that we find in Plato over 2,000 years ago, but even before Plato, when we trace its roots through Plato, the Greek, we see that Plato himself existed in a margin where Europe met the rest of the world. And his ideas were informed by his being a soul at that margin. a soul connected in two ways. With Europe, with a system of analytic, scientific thinking that was gradually assembling itself and only beginning to dawn on people through the thinkers of his age, and with a whole lot of other traditions, among whom there were their own. There were other sciences that in some ways were more subtle, sciences that were more developed, such as mathematics. And when we realized that Plato asked exactly this question, who am I really? How do I get to be a good one of the kind of thing I am? And realize that he answered in respect of these two great registers of connection, a connection to symbols and value and communication, and a connection to the actual physical world. We then realize something about how we are located in the biggest possible order of things, and that is the fundamental realization of all religions. I'm going to stop there and give us time for questions.
All right, thank you very much. So, yes. So James is the gentleman with the microphone, and I also asked James to feel free to get things started and ask a question, but if you do have a question, please get his attention. And I think we have somebody over where I'm pointing now, just on the left hand side.
I'm sort of thinking that all the questions we're going to ask are things you face in the first month of a lecture for first year students or something like that. In the description there of the soul being formed through narrative and context, is there a worry that you then start placing a value that, to my mind, should be somewhat separated? If you have somebody who's born into a vegetative state, yes, and they have no narrative, or a very limited narrative, yes, that, and they're not able to place themselves within a context, what is their soul? I would think their soul is just as valuable, if you want to place value on these things, as anybody else's, but their narrative and context are very, very limited.
I agree with you. In that as a human being who has come among us, we are of course committed to taking up a certain stance, a stance of value. In that human being's potential to actually grow and develop within that context of value is sadly and tragically limited. There are certain commitments in terms of keeping that person among us that I don't think have the same binding force on us that they would otherwise have. Because it's our interest in allowing that potential to develop to its fullest that we lavish upon the human being, a kind of care and nurture that will bring them through to their potential. If that potential doesn't exist, then lavishing that care and nurture in an attempt to make something the case that is not the case is kind of illusory. It's a mistake. So my particular attitude to Anne and Capella children would be that we should not inappropriately be trying to create the possibility of developing a value in them which they have no potential for.
So where does that place us then within, to me there's then, I like to think there's going to be some separation between the value of the soul, that everybody has equal value by having a soul, but then this development through narrative and context is somewhat separated from soul, it's some other aspect of being a person, of humanity. Otherwise, we're left in a position where we could start placing value when it comes to medical treatment, etc. Smarter people should get better medical treatment because they have more potential.
The idea of potential is not quite the same as the idea of realization. Human potential, in that sense, is open-ended. The course of development could take a number of different forms. And in a sense, it would be quite wrong to rank those forms. To be realistic, however, about how much development is possible and how much of a place among us that person is going to take, how much of a place among us the psyche, which is exactly the same word as soul, psyche, in Greek said it as, but, and in the German you still get that sense, but we've got the English word soul, of course. To get the sense of the extent to which a soul needs our giving, our self-giving, to allow it to become the rich thing that it can be, is also to get the sense that for some who come among us, that development is not possible, and that our fitting treatment of their souls, in a sense, is to lament that which cannot be, but not try and delude ourselves that it can be.
In all of this, language is the key to our connection. And understanding how beautiful their relationships with their friends and clubs, and stayed with them, didn't go everywhere, hither and thither, that they now have a solid group of friends that mean so much to them, and I envy them for that, because I know that was insane. So it's wonderful being a human being, and I just love what you're saying.
What you've just remarked upon has become a very strong strain of developmental cognitive psychology. Actually, our ability to recognize and respond to what other human beings do, up until about the age of 9 months, is not much different from the ability of other primates. And then, at about 9 months, the fact that children intuitively recognize that others are trying to connect with them, communicate to them, suddenly sets them apart from primates. And they step into what one philosopher has called a loaded slingshot, constituted by the human use of language, in which through our connections with other human beings, the world is opened up for us in a very different way from the way we could ever see it from our own individual point of view. And that possibility, despite some of its precursors being there in primates, is not something that ever exists in the same way in primates. And even though it seems like a tiny cognitive step to actually latch on to the fact that these other beings like me are trying to communicate to me, are having what we call semantic intentions, meaningful intentions. It just marks a huge step in the possibility of the growth and development of the soul. Suddenly I begin to see the world as it is seen from those multiple points of view from which other people see it. And I can take those things on or reject them. I can take what bits of them I want, but the world is no longer my world. It's our world. And our world has in it a myriad of possibilities that were it only ever my world, that could never happen.
Okay, the next question.
So, you said very early on in your talk that you flirted or you considered Buddhism and Hinduism. And that sort of jumped out at me because I've become very interested in meditation as a way to investigate my own consciousness. And you talked about the soul as being a collection of connections, say, very loosely paraphrased, but it's about your relationship to the world. Now, in meditation, the goal, I mean, this is generally this, Buddhism is particularly about meditation, but it's also in Hinduism, it's also in Christianity as well, as a Christian meditation tradition. And in meditation, you're of course, you're objectively, by say, paying attention to your breath, you're objectively just noticing the consciousness of consciousness and non-judgmentally just letting it go, just seeing what comes up, what comes away. So, as you can talk about this consciousness prior to any kind of relationship and the significance of that. And in Buddhism particularly, there's a tradition of people leaving society and going away and meditating for decades and basically being alone. And their consciousness changed dramatically over this course in time. By their own accounts and by other people's accounts, their consciousness changes for the better. And having no relationship to civilization, essentially, during that time, I'm interested to know what you think has happened to their consciousness and what the true significance of it is. What's happened?
Okay, I'm going to go back to this slide. Now, if you notice, in the picture at the right end, broad areas of the brain are connected together in a very active way. Now, in a meditation state, that happens at a certain frequency, the alpha frequency. The alpha frequency is not the frequency that is dominant in your brain when you're problem solving, when you're applying yourself to a set cognitive task with a set goal. It is a frequency that's much more dominant in your brain when you are being open to the world and whatever it brings to you, without particularly seeking to drive it in any particular direction. So the thought is that even though in normal, active, everyday, being busy about the world consciousness, you are actively recruiting the various bits of the brain you need to solve the problem that you've got at that moment, in meditation, you are clearing away that sort of selective blindness to things which might distract you from solving your problem and opening your mind to whatever happens to come to you. Now, so to answer, I want to answer your question in two bits. The first bit is just the practice of meditation. When you do that, there are certain hormonal and physiological changes in your body which are much more typical of the healing state than the stressed state. The second thing follows on from where I got to at the very end. The thought that all by yourself you can conceive this apparently impersonal universe as being a locus of care and nurture for you and for others who are equally as valuable as yourself, even though at the moment you're not in contact with them, is of course a thought in which you are implicitly allowing yourself to be reaching emotively into a number of possible relationships. If I were a Maori mystic or meditator, I would say relationships with the trees, with the birds, with the mountains, with the rivers as the streams of thought running through the land, with the winds on the grasses as they show the forces of the earth moving over its surface. Seeing all those things as part of and tied to my own being is, by accounts of most of those people who have reported on their meditation and been monitored electrophysiologically while they're doing it, quite a transformative experience. It is, in a sense, generalizing the personhood of being cared for oneself to the whole of the cosmos. If I were to use a Hindu term, I would use the term Atman. That which is most primarily real of myself
and that which is most primarily real of everything that there is. A certain kind of Jewish thinker would not want to name that, because one is supposed not to say the name of God. But God is an intensely personal, in the Judeo-Christian, well, in the Mosaic religions, let's say, God is an intensely personal presence who constitutes one's own individual being through God's own thinking of the world into creative existence. In fact, a very influential philosopher of the 16th century, Benedict Spinoza, used to use the complex term God or nature. And Spinoza is perhaps the most influential thinker in terms of many of the contemporary mystical Christian thinkers who've been writing about a mystical understanding of the Christian faith.
Thank you. Any other questions?
I don't know how to do it. It's complicated. You're talking about the beginning of life. I'm curious about people who appear to have been very, very bright and now cognitively are no longer able to function. But my hope and my hope is that the soul that was existing on the exterior doesn't appear to actually be, but within the interior that you cannot experience, that it still exists. Has there been any research? Or is that too much to ask?
There is no direct research on that idea. My own thinking about this has been greatly influenced by Maori Kaumātua, who came to see a young 16-year-old woman who had put herself into a vegetative state by swallowing her own vomit after a New Year's Eve party and basically suffocating or denying her brain any oxygen, to the point where all of the upper high-level circuits in the brain had been destroyed. The Kaumātua produced, as we spoke to her about whether we should be continuing to feed this young woman with a nasogastric tube, said, there's one thing you don't understand. Her spirit has a journey to go on, and your tubes are keeping her here, so she cannot go on that journey. Now, the thinking that was there is also thinking found in East Asian Japanese thought in a number of strands of East Asian and indigenous thought, that in fact our manifest closely connected activity in the world, in the proximate world, the world of our everyday activities and problem solving, is only a phase of life. It's a phase we grow into, and a phase we grow out of. And at either end of that phase, we come to connect with the ultimate reality of all things, which can be understood physically or can be understood spiritually. They're just two different ways. And can be understood according to the Mosaic religions personally. Those are three different ways of understanding the same thing. That from which we all came, that in which we all participate, and that to which we will all go.
different cultures have different ways of understanding this time-limited crisis that we call mortality. The thought is that the person who comes into the world reaches a point of formation, which is the point we most commonly identify, the point at which they are doing what we would call their own thing in the world, with enough assurance to let us think that they're, in a sense, they're making their own story. And then at a certain point, making your mark, leaving your story fully realized in the world to the extent it can be given the potential you have, no longer becomes your concern. Your concern is to rediscover your ultimate unity with the most fundamental ground of your being. And in First Nations thinking, for instance, I apologize to any First Nations people who might be here and who feel that I'm misrepresenting this, but I've spoken to many of you and found the view extremely interesting in view of Maori thinking as well. First Nations thinking, that is what older people and children connect so well. They're both close enough to the reality from which we all emerge, so that their concerns are similar. Their concerns are to, at the beginning of life, are to define yourself in relation to an apparently inescapable physical world that you suddenly find yourself in. At the end of life, it is to retain your connection with that world as long as you should, for the sake of those who need you. And then at a certain point, to realize that you're not going to be able to hold on to it any longer, and that in fact you should let it go and go where you're supposed to be going anyway. So the idea that there is a continuity through this, manifest in different ways at different times, and that continuity, that whole thing, is what we call the human soul, is the idea that is coming through these various ways of understanding human life.
As we find it out, does someone else have a question?
Thank you. It's very interesting to hear you this evening, and I'm particularly interested in the, what you were talking about at the end of your lecture, where you were looking at spirituality and the biology of life and how that leads into meaning. And I'm wondering if you can comment on the work of Bruce Lipton. Bruce Lipton, his work on the biology of life, and where he looks at the development of conscious thought and unconscious thought in a small child. And, you know, where he talks about that being developed at different stages in life, and that we don't actually acquire the ability to think consciously until the age of 12, I think he said. And if you would have thoughts on this, I'd be interested to know what you think.
Consciousness, on the account I'm trying to give, and actually on the account illustrated on the slide, exists in degrees. The degree of formation it has as you emerge from your lack of distinctness from everything else around you is limited. And then your consciousness goes through a stage of becoming increasingly articulate. As you learn to name what's going on in you, identify it, keep track of it, communicate it, seek enlightenment on it from others to whom you're communicating.
It then reaches a point where you are fully, well, as near as needs be, equally adept to communicate about your own articulate experience as those others around you. And then at a certain stage, your desire to take a full part in that communicative, effective, executive adult world fails some, and your desire to realize your own oneness with what you really are becomes more dominant. That's the line of thought that I'm taking here. One of our problems in contemporary society, according to most indigenous cultures, is that we tend to evaluate the whole of life in terms of that articulate, executive, problem-solving phase. And that is only a limited span of anybody's life. If it exists in isolation from the more fundamental realizations that give life their true value, then it becomes an impoverished. And ultimately, if I was to use the language of the East, a world of illusions. If, however, it takes its proper place, where you have an executive and articulate contribution to make to the lives of everybody you're in touch with, that's fine. That's what it should be like for that period of time. But to expect you to go on doing that and to evaluate you as somehow defective because you are, that is not your primary concern anymore. You have other things to do. You have memories to hold on to and pass on. You have a sense of the value of things to convey just by the way you conduct yourself. You have commitment to also communicate and to help communicate to those who need to have it from you, their own value and worth. So often, for instance, children in dysfunctional settings will find that the place they have to go to learn about their own worth is to their grandparents. Well, that's, in a sense, as it should be. Their parents, at that time, when they're in that unfortunate setting, are usually so focused and locked into the problems they're trying to solve in their life, they haven't got time to value their children. Whereas their grandparents, if they're around and in touch, have or should have an intuitive understanding that that is an intensely important thing they can do for those children.
Given the neck of the woods that you hail from, I was curious to know if you had any engagement with Smart, Place, Armstrong, and more recently Chalmers, because disproportionately for the Australasian population, philosophy of mind has been incredible. Not that I necessarily buy into it, but I would imagine that you are an outlier, philosophically speaking, in that world.
Unfortunately, that is true. There is an Australasian Society for Continental Philosophy now. So there's a bunch of outliers. I'm often encouraged by a remark made by Bernard Williams, one of the greatest of the Cambridge philosophers, who once was having a conversation at a philosophical conference and was recalled as saying to somebody, "Isn't it curious that Australasian materialism is only actually believed in Australasia?" Perhaps that's because it's only actually true in oscillation. Now, for those of you who are not among the cognoscenti, oscillation materialism is the view that the mind and these more abstract things are just a matter of the functional, computational work actually going on in the human brain. And of course, that's not quite the line of thought that I'm wanting to take. This line of connectivity and potentially inarticulate elements of thought which take me beyond those things I can immediately factor into my functional problem solving as a manifestation of my own intellect, to me is not what mind is all about. It's part of it. And in fact, that's Aristotle's view also. Aristotle devotes chapter 7, part of chapter 7 of the Nicomachean Ethics, to distinguishing between cleverness, the ability to solve a problem to achieve the ends you want to achieve, from true wisdom, the ability to assess the ends you have adopted, to see whether they really are good ends to which you should be committing yourself. And he makes it quite clear that you can be a human being who has developed his cleverness. He only talked about his women didn't figure in philosophy in Aristotle. You can be a human being who developed his cleverness to the extent that it has eclipsed his ability to grasp what was truly good and worth committing yourself to in life.
So we have about a half an hour still for questions.
Thank you for giving my mind and brain a good scratch this evening, and I'm wide awake now. You might have already answered this question indirectly, but the question is, can machines have souls? So in the context of artificial intelligence, and if we extrapolate forward 50, 100 years, what are the thresholds or the tests that would have to pass for us to say, yes, machines have souls?
And you sound to me like a person who's recently seen the film The Imitation Game.
Yes.
As I indeed have myself. The first thing we need to understand about genes is that they're not real. There are no genes. Genes are a fiction we have created to explain the fact that DNA molecules have a particular part to play and the way the characteristics of parents manifest themselves in their children. As a construct which looks at the complicated process whereby DNA does recreate in one's children, depending on the circumstances, a version of the characteristics that have also been created in you. Of course, they're incredibly useful, particularly where that construct has a very direct relationship to a disease condition, like Huntington's disease, for instance. And there it becomes almost true to talk about a gene for Huntington's. Not quite, but almost. What we then have to do is ask how this particular construction or abstraction, which allows us to explain how it is that the characteristics of certain parents are manifest in a recognizable way, to a certain extent, in their children, we then have to realize that that is a very different kind of intellectual exercise from the intellectual exercise of trying to understand what it is about any particular human being that makes them the distinct human being they are, with their own way of being in the world, which is absolutely characteristic of us, and involves quirks of behavior, deep commitments, beliefs, the fact that you happen to support a certain hockey team rather than a different one, and all that kind of stuff. Now, for Aristotle, that second kind of intellectual activity is the kind that tells us about a person's soul. Why does this person walk the way they do, talk the way they do, have the attitudes they do, think things through in the way they do, find themselves naturally and comfortably related to a certain different kind of person, support a particular sports team, and so on and so forth. All those things are definitive of the unique soul of that person. That gene, a construct allowing a certain kind of explanation of hereditability, could ever be like that. I mean, it's just the wrong kind of thing. It's like saying, gosh, why don't the players in Manchester United use hockey sticks? You don't use hockey sticks to play soccer. You do incorporate boots, but not skates. Playing soccer with skates is an extremely perilous business. So some elements that are evident in hockey are also evident in soccer. But to describe a good soccer player, I don't know, to think about it, is to describe a whole lot more than just what sort of a muscle he's got in his calf. Of course he uses his calf muscles, and if he didn't have calf muscles, he couldn't play soccer. But it's only a small part of the picture. Just as, of course, we are in part dependent on our genes and what they give us from our parents. But our parents give us a lot more. Habits, training, love, commitment, values, attitudes, ways of thinking about the world, books to read, and all that kind of stuff. And somehow or other, when you coalesce all those things together, you begin to get a picture of what a human soul is.
You see, that answer, to me, connects to a couple of the questions early on. What if somebody, and you know, to paraphrase what may or may not have been in a couple of questions, what if the notion that maybe there's something human and almost impossible to describe in words that means that a human being has a soul, is it possible even a human being not able to do the thinking that you see on that scan, there's something about humans having souls that aren't detected in a brain scan? I mean, I assume some people believe that. Beyond the sort of personal theological belief, what's the likelihood of that being true?
You're virtually describing the difference between a dualistic conception of the soul, whereby it's something that a person can have, completely independent of the way they become, versus the Aristotelian as it happens, Thomistic, St. Thomas Aquinas. And some would say Judaic conception of the soul, where your soul is who you are and who you become. So you are a soul in the, it's not something you have, like a kind of immaterial handbag that you might happen to lose someday. You are a soul in that you're a person of a certain kind with certain connections to other people. If you're born without the possibility of any of those things ever developing, then the soul you are is a very limited soul. What we can do for you, what we can help you to develop, is, as I said right at the very beginning, very limited, and we should recognize that. Above that point, the moment you begin to show some possibilities of actually developing within this world we call our human life, the whole question changes, and your potential becomes something we really have to take seriously and value and generously work with you to achieve.
We'll go to questions after, but I just want to follow up one thing, is that it sounds when you answer that way that maybe you're answering a slightly different question, that how do we decide how much effort and work do we put in to nurturing that person if they have a limited ability to gain all the kinds of things that you use as the definition of soul? So that's kind of a, you know, an ethicist question, right? But putting that aside, if someone's not asking you how many resources should we put in it, but is it possible that in a meaningful way that person has a soul, even though their brain may not have the potential to build all these relationships and gain this knowledge, do you feel the answer to that is yes or no in terms of the existence of a soul in a meaningful way for that person?
Okay. The soul is predicated on something. It's not just predicated on human tissue, because a piece of human tissue, in fact, a fully autonomously growing piece of human tissue, could in fact be a malignant tumor known as a hydatidiform mole. It's got, it starts off looking identical to many other human embryos, but the human tissue that it is will never form the kind of being of which we would properly say that being has a human soul. So the reality that we have here is that this bit of humanity, biologically one with us in a certain kind of way, doesn't have what it takes to be a human soul. Whereas this other bit that is forming itself in such a way as we can see it heading towards having a role among us as a being whose human potential is being realized, does it. And therefore our treatment of the second kind of thing, the piece of human tissue who is becoming one of us, occurs in a completely different framework of thinking from our treatment of the piece of human tissue who is not becoming one of us and never will be.
Thank you. Back to the floor.
This is slightly related to Ian's question. I've pondered from time to time whether religious experience occurs in the primitive part of the brain. I think it's called the autonomic part of the brain.
Yeah.
Now after that, analysis and thinking what it means and changing one's life and so forth is in the cerebellum, the analytic part. But if that is correct, then it would mean that people in the middle and left of your picture are still capable of religious experience. Yeah. And pushing it to an extreme, that could apply to animals, because they still have the same primitive part of the brain. Thank you.
Okay. When you do the appropriate studies of brain activity during religious experience, you find a picture that's very much towards the right-hand end, and usually somewhere from about here up, from about here down, that looks to be quite different as a statistical group of brain activities. You then have to think about what you actually mean by religious experience. If you accept, as I do, that basically, even if the brain started off as quite a modular structure in which quite specialized functions enabled the primitive creature whose brain it was to get by in the world, by the time it's got to be a human brain up the evolutionary scale, it's working almost totally by integration, by combining the various specialized functions into a bigger whole. And religious experience, when it can be, when it most obviously overlaps with the kind of experiences we monitor which seem to be religious, like what we see is a neural activity in the temporal lobes of the brain. So some people have concluded that the temporal lobes of the brain, which have to do with memory and emotion and being caught up in a whole bigger than yourself, what Freud called an oceanic feeling. Some people have concluded that that is a God model. Most mystics and the experiments are only now being done actually evidence a much broader range of activity in their brain. Yes, the temporal lobes are very active, and they're active in a very non-problem directed way, but they're caught up into a bigger whole, and that bigger whole, WHOLE, may have a lot of symbolic connections for that person. So that those symbolic connections may be richer and deeper, one could use the term richer anyway, more full of ideas, depending on the extent to which the person has developed and thought about and connected up their religious experiences with a faith context usually, whatever that faith is. So the emotive or primitive parts of the brain do have a part to play, because religious experience is very captivating and absorbing, and transform, and all of those transformative things come from the parts of the brain that involve fundamental orientations towards the world. But it's also got this other and broader aspect to it, where the more one develops that experience, connects it up with other areas of your life and thought and work, the more it becomes not just that, but something much more encompassing. Now, of course, God, if there is a God, and if that God is going to speak to you, and if the way that God is going to speak to you is going to move you emotionally and make you think about things in the broadest possible way, then if such a God were to speak to you, that would show up in your brain as these kinds of patterns. So whether or not those kinds of patterns are just occurring because of something else that's going on in your life, or whether they're occurring because your God has spoken to you, is not something that all the brain studies can answer.
We have about 10 minutes in case you want to summon up the courage to ask one of the last few questions. Yes, please go ahead.
Thank you. I'm not sure this will sound terribly articulate, especially after the last question, but it was about the same material coming from a different perspective. Humans use a solitary confinement, but the absence of interaction or the I in relation to the world part that you defined as a soul, as a form of punishment. Some people, like mystics, may choose it voluntarily, but we do use it as a punishment. Do you have to have developed to the stage of having the interactions in order for it to be punishment? And then, on top of that, have humans conceptualized God, whatever God is, as a human to be able to have the relationship part that puts it in the realm of things we can understand? The relationship with God, if we could conceive of it as being with another human, or being a relationship, it's the relating part that makes it.
Okay. That's a very interesting question, so you shouldn't have felt nervous about asking. As we tell our medical students, and I'm sure you do too, there's not good or bad questions. There's only the questions that do get asked and the questions that don't get asked. And what's absolutely sure is from the questions that don't get asked, you don't learn anything. We don't learn anything from the person who's trying to teach. So, it's a... The very fact that we are interpersonal or intersubjective beings from the moment we are born, where the dimensions of that intersubjectivity become increasingly elaborate, from the very simple subconscious, almost reflexive imitation and kind of dynamic mirroring of the face of the person nearest to you, which starts happening when you're only a few hours old, to this complex capacity to inflect what you say, how you say it, and the exact words you choose in response to the way the person you're speaking to is showing your own registration. That intersubjective process, which complexifies, develops, and becomes all-encompassing for human beings, creates both possibilities. The possibility of being punished by having it taken away from you, the possibility of wanting to escape all the distractions and letting that crystallize or settle itself into new shapes in a kind of solitude in which you're in touch with the context of your being but not with all the immediate demands that other human beings make. Both those possibilities spring out. Our best theory of dreaming, for instance, is that we dream because we need to reshuffle the deck of cognitive cards every night. Every day we have this stream of experiences which create all sorts of complex possibilities. Every night our brain goes into, let's just play with this stuff mode, where we're not actually directing it in any direction at all. And in our brain, stories start to form, of which we're a part. And the stream of experiences of the day shuffle themselves down into all sorts of new shapes. Now, if you're dominated by fear and anxiety, then those dreams are going to take certain forms. If you're dominated by what's called flow, or productivity and creativity, satisfaction in what you're doing, they'll take a different series of forms. But in each case, your brain is just letting the ideas spark up, make new connections, and then seeing where they fall after that. And in a sense, one can see the person going into a process of meditation after a period of spiritual interaction and instruction is doing that thing. Saying, my head is now stuffed with all the things I've learned. I need some time for them all just to settle, shuffle around, possibly bring me new insights. And exactly the way that a mathematician might, for instance, put aside a problem at 10 o'clock at night, go off to the pub, have a drink, go to sleep, and wake up in the morning suddenly with the solution that he could not, or she could not see the night before clear in his mind. So, I think both possibilities come about from the normal richness of our experience. It's easy to see how it can be punishing. It's sometimes a little bit more difficult to see how it can also be part of the creative process that allows us to reach new levels of insight, when in fact argument and discussion seems to be a much more powerful way of doing it. But we underestimate the extent to which, at a certain point, our brain has these magnificent capacities to just shuffle information around in a quasi-random, but actually not random way, and come up with new orientations towards the problems that we've given it to solve.
Time for maybe one or two questions. Anyone have a question that they'd like to ask? No? Okay, I'm not missing anybody. We didn't even know. Okay, here's one more, and this will be the last.
It's not a technical question, but I just
wondering. One way, we'll get the microphone to you.
I was just wondering what it is that has brought you to Vancouver and to Canada. Are you going on to give some other talks, or?
Yeah, Mary Lou carried it for me to Vancouver to talk at a conference on Friday on Beacons of Hope. The conference is called Beacons of Hope. My particular task is to say something about recent research into neuroplasticity and the implications of that research for cognitive impairment and the cognitive decline of aging. Now, as a matter of fact, it turns out that neuroplasticity, or the ability to reform and restructure your brain in the context of rich human experience and interaction, does have an amazing effect on what is coming to be called the brain and cognitive reserve, or BCR in the literature.
which is hugely protective against Alzheimer's disease. Much more protective than any drug that has so far been researched. And it turns out that even something as simple as walking for 20 minutes a day, particularly if you're walking with somebody with whom you can also converse, is quite protective. Actually more effective than most drugs. And that doing active cognitive work, like playing bridge or playing certain kinds of computer games, or gardening, or problem solving with crosswords, or actively reading demanding books, but actually not watching television, are also hugely protective against the pace and severity of Alzheimer's changes. And so there's a lot to be said now that we're only just beginning to learn about neuroplasticity and the importance of the nervous system renewing itself, reforming its connections, and if we pick up the language we're using today, remaking the soul continually and creatively as life goes on. I could say a lot of other things. One of my co-researchers in Dunedin has done a lot of work on the way people from different decades of life solve problems. And it turns out that an older person has much more streamlined and directed ways of solving any problem that they're given. Now that leads to gains in efficiency, but it also leads to less recruitment of other brain areas that may come up with a novel solution to the problem. And it also means that if they are distracted or thrown off their preferred strategy for solving that problem, they don't quite have the same flexibility as a younger person who hasn't quite as closely developed their skills of dealing with those problems. So, you know, there's so much work going on in all of this.
Well, thank you very much. Thanks to everyone who is here. Tomorrow I'll be back on CBC News Network doing neurologically challenging television. So I'll be very good for your plasticity, I promise. And, I would have to say to Shaughnessy Heights, I commend you for all the work that was done in organizing this, for having a guest that not only is challenging people's sense perhaps of what the soul is, but also sits up here and at one point says, if there is a God, there are not a lot of other churches that would probably have a guest speaking in their sanctuary on that topic. So it was a good evening, obviously, for all the people who stayed here. We really enjoyed that. Your physical ability to get on that plane this morning, tomorrow morning, yesterday, whatever that was, and get here. I know your strategy is to get through this evening and then fall flat in your hotel bed, but it's as amazing as your background and also how generously and smartly you answered the questions today. So on behalf of all of us, thank you very much.
Yes, certainly.